Hello, good evening. Can everybody hear me okay? Alright, thanks for putting up with a little delay. We were hoping that a few more people would come in, and a few people have walked in the last few minutes, so still have a smaller crowd than expected, but either way, we'll go ahead and get started. Hopefully a few more people will come in, and then people in also. First of all, let me wish all of you a Happy New Year. It's still early in the new year, so I wish you all the best for 2016. We live in a beautiful little place in the world, so I see Tim over here. He's always smiling when we talk about Saba, but this is a great place to be. So no matter, we're here to talk about some of the problems that we have, but we should always remember that we do live in a beautiful paradise, and we have to keep our little treasure very good. And I wish you all the best for 2016. This evening, I'm here to talk about the standpoint of the island government of Saba with regards to the evaluation report from the Committee of His Best Speeds. I have discussed this issue on a number of occasions, and I know some of you have already heard me give this speech a few different times before, whether it was on radio or through the island council meetings. So I'll try to be a little bit more concise tonight with my information. Hopefully only speak for about maybe half an hour, and that might be a bit long. I'm going to be a little long-winded, so I apologize in advance. But then hopefully we can have a good discussion about it, or we can also get some input from those of you out there. The idea for this evening is that I will talk a little bit in general at first about this and the lead up to it, to the evaluation, to the report. Then I would like to read, I don't know if I can get one of the copies of the report, actually, I don't know. I would like to read the standpoint from us. I would like to read the executive summary to everybody. I think it gives a good outline of the report. And then we will go through a PowerPoint presentation with some of the highlights about the report. I hope that some of you, or most of you, had a chance to actually read this. So that would make for some good conversation tonight. But if not, I do ask you to please take the time over the next few days and read it. And this will be the basis for us moving forward through this evaluation process and through negotiations about the status that we have here in Saba and also in Station and Bonaire. So a quick introduction. The lead up to this evaluation, as you all know, most of you already know the history of this very well. Before 10-10-10, we were part of the Netherlands Antilles. And during the negotiations, there was a signing of the so-called Slot Accord in 2006. And when that was signed, it was agreed that Saba Station and Bonaire would become public entities or will become part of the Netherlands. The agreed upon status hasn't been concluded as yet. But it was agreed that after 5 years of the new status, there would be an evaluation to see what the effect of this had been on the people here and on society and the framework and everything. So that was the original agreement from 2006. There were a few different dates that the transition was supposed to happen. It was first supposed to be in July of 2007, and then it was 2008, then it was the beginning of 2010, and then it went to the symbolic date of 10-10-10. I think we all know the history of that. Just to highlight a few different issues that I'd like to bring up. We are here tonight to talk about the negative aspects of our status, let's say, to talk about what needs to be changed. But often I do remind people that many people remember the Netherlands Antilles in this nostalgic way. We remember all the great Netherlands Antilles. And I would like to remind some people also of what we knew from government and what we used to have to face in the Netherlands Antilles. For example, those days our budget was merely a wish list. We had a budget of 27 million guilders from Saba that was passed through the Island Council. The actual amount of money that we received from the Solidarity Fund at the time was around 12 million. I think we had about 3 million in local revenues. So the total budget of Saba was around 15 million guilders. So the Island Council would pass this budget of 27 million guilders, but in actuality, you had to work with 15 million guilders per year to run the island. Saba operated as if it was its own republic for many years. We had our own educational system. We used English as the language of instruction. We had our own healthcare system. We had Saba healthcare, our own health insurance. You know, so even though we were part of a country, in reality, we had almost full autonomy. We were like an independent country that would once a year get a small injection. That way, in certain ways, that was very good because we were in control of our own island, and we felt that we were really the masters of our destiny. But on the other hand, we were really broke as a government. And I always use the example of, for example, medical charters. You know, there was a period then that the island government would be so broke that Wenaer didn't even want to lend us or to give us any more credit. So if somebody had a medical emergency and had to be flown to St. Martin, we would have to, Bruce Zegers, the Commissioner of Finance, would have to call down to see if there was $1,000 available just to charter a flight for Wenaer. And those are realities that we used to face. And we say that, you know, in no system should a politician be making decisions that a doctor should make. You know, if a doctor decides that you have to be flown out for a medical evacuation, you should have to be flown out for a medical evacuation, and that should not be based just on the budget. So there were realities of both sides. And, of course, now with our new status, there are also realities of both sides of this. With the new status, we had quite a lot of bureaucracy that has been put in place. You know, in Nellis and Tillis, we talked a lot about the democratic deficit. We were one member out of 22, the parliament of 22 of the Nellis and Tillis. One of our former senators is here, Mr. Ray Hassel, and I'm sure he can tell you that, you know, being one member out of 22 members, there was not much that you can do. Well, imagine now we have no members in the second chamber, and the Dutch government has 150 members of the second chamber of Tweede Kamer. So whatever democratic deficit we had before in a country of about 200,000 people is amplified so much more of being in a country of 17 million people in the Netherlands. It doesn't mean that we don't get attention in these small islands. We have quite some delegations come through, not only from government, but our local population has met many Dutch politicians, ministers, members of the first chamber, second chamber, and we have quite a contact with them. The problem that we face in general is that the Netherlands is a developed democracy with a large government, and they have a certain way of doing things. If you read the report from the Committee of the Vesties, you will see that that's found there that they notice it throughout the report that the Dutch ministries and Dutch civil servants are used to dealing with the European context. They're used to dealing with very large populations, with very general policies, and they're not used to dealing with a small island of 1,500 people. And by I say 1,500 people is, yes, we have 2,000, but 500 really are with medical school that are temporary residents. So we have 1,500 permanent residents that live here. Of course, also the status affects the temporary residents, but not as much as the local residents. So when you're determining policy for an island of 1,500 people, and you're used to doing that for a large country, you can imagine that there will be some holdups there. With that, you know, like I said, there are pros and cons of both sides, but we're here mainly to talk about the things that haven't gone well during the implementation stage of this. When we had the Netherlands and Tillys breaking up, we have to remember also that it was the creation of the country of Curaçao, creation of the country of St. Martin. So we were grouped together with Statia and with Bonaire, which also, those of us who know these islands, you know that there are vast differences between Saba, Statia, and Bonaire. All three of the islands are different. In fact, all six of the Dutch islands are very different. St. Martin is very different from Curaçao and what have you. So it's hard to make policy across the board for three small different islands and have those all as one common set of laws. That is a common problem that we face. But with the lead up to 10-10-10, there were many discussions. I often feel that at times there was a feeling of the islands that we had more influence than we did. That can be regrettable. If I'm at fault in some of those areas, then I have to take blame for that too. But you know, when you're dealing with, like I said, the Ministry of Finance from the Netherlands, and they come with packages of laws of 150 pages. For example, the business community here was very involved in a lot of those presentations. They came with a first proposal, they came with a second proposal, they came with a third proposal. The third proposal was presented here to these islands for the tax structure. It included an income tax of 10.4%, it included many different aspects. And when they went to the second chamber, they had a fourth proposal. That proposal was never presented here, was never agreed upon. That was their law proposal. The only agreement for taxes for the three islands had in the Netherlands was something in 2009 And it's a small little A4 paper that just has a few paragraphs on it written in highlights, that the tax structure would be simple, that the burden would not be increased. Those are the type of things that were agreed upon. It was never 150 laws, 150 page laws that went to the second chamber that were voted on, deliberated on. So that is what we had to face with the democratic deficit, and that is also a reality that has had an effect on many of these islands. Another example I use is that I think many of the Dutch civil servants, and I don't mean this in a negative way, but it means that they're good at what they do, but a lot of them learn their lessons in the Netherlands and through their jobs and use that down here when setting up the system. We talked about a simplified tax structure. Well, before 10-10-10, we used to have a turnover tax. Turnover tax was charged on 3% of your total turnover as a business. You had to go to 15 of the month and you paid it, one-time payment, and that was the contribution to the turnover tax. Their version of a simplified system was the offering of the savings belasting or the general consumption tax, which is basically like an import tax. So then that's 6% on all goods coming in, but also then 4% on all services. So when you talk about the store owners here and the merchants having from before once a month having to pay one bill on the 15th of the month to then having to pay over 10 bills of laden or 20 bills of laden or how many per shipment every week having to go through to calculate per item, that is not a simplified system. It's simple for the tax department. It's not simple for the business owner or the person down here. So for them, I believe that they learned their lessons. And like I said, I mean, I can't blame them for doing it because it makes sense. But however, we were the ones that had to face the brunt of that down here in the islands. You know, so when you talk about simple for them, is that they don't have to prove what your 3% is. Before, you know, you could say, well, 3% of my business was so much, and then you paid it on the 15th of the month. What is very simple for the tax department is to say, okay, I know exactly what you purchased, and this is your tax bill. So the enforcement part is simple, but it doesn't mean that it translates to being simple the way they want to put it. So there's many examples of that. There's a lot of examples of bureaucracy, of where simple things like work permits, those are done on a European mind frame. Europe, they have the Schengen visa. It's a very controlled continent, if you can, the European Union, to get visas to come in and what have you. And they're not flexible in certain areas. They also don't have to deal with things that we have to deal with. For our schools, if you have, you need to get an English-speaking teacher, and they come from the English Caribbean or independent countries around here, there is such an unbelievable process just to get one of those people coming here. Well, in the Netherlands, the schools also are in Dutch. So if you have to get a Dutch teacher, you don't have to regulate a work permit for the teacher. So it's situations a lot that they wouldn't have to even think about that we are forced with down here and we have to deal with. So we have a top-heavy bureaucracy, we have a lot of laws that don't make sense, and that is a little bit about what we want to get in here to this evening. In the last months, on the 12th of October, well, over the last year, there was the evaluation committee that was installed to deal with the agreement from 2006 from the Slaughter Board. The evaluation committee came here many times. A lot of you here tonight I have seen here before for those meetings. Lisbeth Spies, Luke Verhey, Glenn Today, Fred Soons, and Frans Wakers, all the members of the evaluation committee. And they spent through that year going around. They had different research groups that they hired from different consultancies and from the university, what have you, to go around and do different aspects of the evaluation to find out about the structure, the structure of the island, the structure of the government, to find out what the effects were on the people. You know, they sat here, they interviewed, they had different work groups and sessions. So with all that came the report, and they produced this report and gave it out on the 12th of October. Based on that report, we feel here, and Stacia and Bonaire, they share a sentiment that we have a little bit of momentum going right now. That we hope, and I probably believe this is maybe the last chance, I don't want to sound pessimistic, but the report was negative enough that we hope that this will give us the chance to make change to the areas that need to be changed once and for all, so that we can correct some of the problems that we've had to face over the past 5 years. That is the basis of their report. The report is actually their report from the Committee of Respected Species, so it's not for me to answer questions specifically for that. But however, the island government then took the initiative to create a standpoint of the constitutional evaluation. So this document has been given out here this evening. This has also been available. This has been made available through the website. And the idea is that right now this is a working document. Just to give a brief introduction to that, we started with collecting information from different stakeholders, which included an e-team at the time, where we talked about a lot of the problems, especially from the merchants that they had faced, specifically with things like the tax structure, with the social premiums, what have you. And then we had from all different sectors, stakeholders that gave in their input. After that, that was compiled together in a report together with people like Mr. Kuhn von Laar, some of our policy workers in government, Mr. Pete Kedison. There's Pete. Okay, right over here. So over the last months of putting that together, cutting, pasting, then this was handed over. We also had, of course, input from the Island Council members at that time, went through, made comments based on the rough draft. This is actually still a draft because we hope that we'll also get some more input that you can hear this evening. So based on that rough draft, the Island Council members also made comments. Most could be incorporated, some couldn't. Some of my comments couldn't. We had to take what we could, consensus as best as possible. And then we handed over the report to the island government. At the time then, what the island government did was that he established an advisory committee on island with people from different sectors of the community. And that advisory committee went through this standpoint and they read it. They also read all of the other reports and they added their comments. They had quite a number of meetings in a 2-week period and gave their discussions. And based on that, also inputs were changed. We had a number of individuals, the governor had a number of individuals on his advisory committee to put that together. And then, when that came back over, then the Executive Council presented it in a public meeting of the Island Council. That was in the middle of December. And then a suggestion came, actually, from Mr. Ishmael Levinson to make sure. He said, "Oh, your town hall meeting, boy." So, sure that we had to have a town hall meeting to see if we could get some more input. Also tried online. People are always welcome to email in, to write in comments. And like I said, I hope you read the report and have a chance to make those comments. Okay, with that, I will go then to reading a bit of the executive summary. It's only a page and a quarter, so if you bear with me. This is on the handout that was given out. And the idea is that it gives the big picture of the report. On October 12, 2015, the established evaluation committee SPIES publicly released their findings in a report entitled Kveikjaar Verbonden, Bonaire's and Justatius in Saba and Europees in Nederland. This document is the official standpoint of the island government of the public entity of Saba in light of the evaluation report and is supported by the Island Council. It will serve as a basis for all negotiations of the members of the Executive Council throughout the reaction process to the evaluation report and reflects the concerns and ideas of the Saban representatives. The document starts with an introduction of the history of the constitutional status, followed by a list of concerns per policy field, and it concludes with a general standpoint of the island government pertaining to the three fields the evaluation is focusing on: legislative framework, administrative framework, and the consensus for the population. The most important points are consequences for the population. The level of provisions and the cost of living needs to be the number one priority for the coming years. In the past 5 years, many improvements have been realized, but as the evaluation report concludes as well, poverty and the cost of living have increased. Targets have to be set for the level of AOV, pension, minimum wage, understanding, which is welfare, and other allowances. And for Nederland and Vaartwaard for Zinnenniveau, so a Dutch or a Netherlands level of provisions, acceptable level of provisions, And the poverty line needs to be translated to numbers. So no longer just talking about what is acceptable or what's not. We need to once and all for all agree to this is what is considered the poverty line, this is acceptable above it, this is unacceptable beneath it. Evaluation reports conclude that the new tax system has created a big burden on the saving population. Evaluation reports describe many of the flaws in the system. Independent evaluation of the tax system is needed to come to a system that is more consumer-friendly and fits the saving situation. Administrative framework. The island government agrees with the evaluation committee that the administrative framework that was created after 10-10-10 has many flaws. The position of the national representative does not work. The voice of the islands is not being heard in The Hague. The island governments do not have the funds and the autonomy to serve the population properly. The national representative should be abolished by the person in the position. Most of the tasks can be shifted to the government. The evaluation report concludes that the position of the governor needs strengthening and the extra responsibilities for good governance strengthen his position. A best advisory council should be introduced to safeguard the interests of the islands and the Hague. The best advisory council consists of authoritative individuals with an affinity for the islands. The capacity of the public entities has to be strengthened. The evaluation reports conclude that the national government does not shift responsibilities to local government because of a lack of professional capacity. The reports also show that the national government has limited knowledge of the islands. Local government is eager to take over responsibilities but does not have the means. The legislative framework. The input of the islands on the legislation for the islands has been minimal. Conclusion that is shared by the evaluation committee. The mandatory consultations were disregarded, and only via an intense lobby was it possible for the islands to have a minimal input on new legislation. The best advisory council needs to get an important role in advising on new legislation for Saba and the other best islands. That executive summary already discusses some of the big pictures, the big discussion points that will come up through the slideshow. So we'll go through the slideshow now and get into a summary. Okay? Don't fall asleep on me. If you do, I can't. When we go through this, throughout that, I'll also discuss some of the big ideas that we have and explain a little bit of what the problem is and why we see it. One quick point before we get into that is to also state that one of the things that we feel, and we hear it a lot from the Netherlands, and I'm sure a lot of people hear it, the Netherlands will tell you they spend 250 million euros per year in these islands, or 300 million euros per year in these islands, and they only collect 100 million euros. Well, one of the points that we continue to make from the governments of the three islands is, how is this money being spent? You know, we have a very large middle government that has been created, about 700 employees that kind of replaced the Netherlands and Tilly's government. It's so-called Rijksoverheid, but it's not really. It falls like kind of in between the island levels and the state level. And this itself costs a fortune. You see a lot of money being spent on consultancies and on research projects. But then when we talk about the old age pension being raised above the poverty line, we continue to have problems with those discussions. We're not want to be beggars and always talk about more, more, more. We would just like to see the money being spent and let it being going to the right people in the way that it should be. Efficient spending is something that I think we can all agree upon. And even in the Netherlands, we always get a good response when we talk about it. So that's a common thread throughout this report. Okay, context and timeline. The committee discussed the report on constitutional evaluation on October 12, 2015. The standpoint of constitutional evaluation is the reaction of the public entity Saba to that report that contains all points that need to be addressed. I want to just say all points. most of the important points, because hopefully we have more points here tonight, and also there's many or some that we probably haven't. The standpoint will form the basis for political discussions on the change that need, on the changes that need to be made. Okay, in the content, the general overview, we discuss the executive summary, which I read for you. It then goes into an introduction and a context, talks about the build-up and about where we are right now. specific points of attention, and then you can see the influence from the interviews we had over the last year and a half with stakeholders. So of course, the number one issue that comes up then is taxes, because when you talk about cost of living has a few different aspects. Social levels, the cost of doing business, you know, lower wages, all of those affect the cost of living. You could pay, you know, $100 for an apple, but if you're making $1,000 a day, then that's not the problem. So it's all relative to your income level. In the section on taxes, like I said, this is a summary for the PowerPoint presentation, but it's actually very in-depth when you go through there, pretty in-depth. We talk about double taxation. That's been commonly discussed here for many years, the buildup of ABB, when it's brought in, when it's sometimes when it's sold, when a service is put on it, and when it's broken down. So that leads to areas of double taxation. There's also, of course, the point of the tax turnover tax from St. Martin that was raised also at the same time from 3% to 5% added to our cost of living. So pay a lot of consumers pay a turnover tax from St. Martin, and then again ABB over here. You have a higher tax pressure because of implementation of the tax system. A lot of times also we use these examples that the Netherlands Antilles was actually a very good country on paper. Netherlands Antilles was based on old Dutch laws from the 50s, which are very good, well-written laws, but the reality is they would never enforce fully. So an economy corrects itself to that situation. It doesn't mean that everybody just took advantage of it. It means to say that the services that were provided, if a taxi driver didn't pay much tax, they corrected their wage, you know, to that. The economy corrected itself to that situation. So it's not that everybody was walking home with fortunes of money. It's just that that was the economy at the time. What happened is that they looked at the amount that should have been carried in by the Netherlands Antilles tax structure and then translated that over to the new tax structure. But in reality, that was not being collected by the tax structure of the Netherlands Antilles. No incentives for investments in the tax system. Well, I shouldn't say no, I should say not many incentives. There is an incentive, I think, for the Vasco Palasting for new buildings for a certain period. We've changed some of that over the last few years. But those things are pointed out throughout this also. It's very hard when you talk about a hotel owner and they have to pay a real estate tax or a Vasco Palasting, and they say, okay, if I fix up my actual hotel, then I have to pay more tax by spending money in my actual hotel to fix it up. You know, there's no more system before the profit tax that you could write off investments and you could use that to raise the value of your property and to make it look nicer and better for the society. There's also the issue of, with the Vasco Belasting, if a hotel only has 50% occupancy compared to 100% occupancy, you pay the same rate across the year. It doesn't take into account when they have highs and lows, which is a reality of doing business. And we put here, independent evaluation is needed. We had people here from the Ministry of Finance and presented a letter to them. They want to do their own evaluation for the tax structure. Pete always says it's like the butcher telling you about the meat. This is some old Dutch saying with the slag in the face or something, but we asked them to please have an independent body do the evaluation, because how can you ask the same people who wrote the system to evaluate it? Of course they tell you it's the best system ever created and it's perfect, there are no flaws. Okay, we move on to health. And if you read in the report, you know, which is also very clear, we have to, but like I said, that's not necessarily the job of the report, but there also have been very good aspects to the transition. Nobody can deny that the healthcare is much better now than it was under the former Netherlands Antilles and when we had our own health insurances. I don't think anybody tries to deny that. Well, I won't bother to argue with it, but I don't see how you could deny that. The healthcare has gotten better for sure. But as we put in the report, however, there can always be improvements. So the point of our position paper is about focusing on those and not just pointing out all the good highlights. So I have to say that for Dr. Glaubo here. So it's going well, but it can always be improved. We have suggestions there about more investments and facilities closer to home. A lot of that also can depend on how the relationship between the Dutch government and the government of St. Martin, but it would make more sense for better facilities to be over there in St. Martin, at least for the patients of Saba and Stacia. you know, and also for families that you can visit family members. So over the long run, the more that those facilities can improve, the better it can be for us here on the island. Decrease the bureaucracy of ZVK. You know, we talk about how long it takes to get different allowances and to book tickets and to come back from doctor visits and all that. So if you can make it more efficient also, I think that would be appreciated by patients and by doctors. Reintroduce dental care and physiotherapy and health insurance. And of course, this is one of those that we use the example a lot, is that at times the system is hypocritical. When you have certain advantages in the Netherlands, they tell you, yeah, but you all are a different island, you're a different municipality, you're a special relationship, you're not the same as in the Netherlands. As soon as they cut certain packages in the Netherlands, then they say, yeah, but you're using Onderdeel from Nederland, you all are a part of the Netherlands, and you have to have the same restrictions. So they go ahead and they cut where they make cuts there. So it's a bit hypocritical of a standpoint that you can always win an argument with that. You know, you can use Article 1.2 of the statute, or you can say, no, you really are part of the Netherlands, Article 134 of the Constitution. Okay, public transportation. This is also a point we continue to bring up, with the high cost, of course, of Guinea. We tell them that when you're living on Saba or Stacia, you have to look at St. Martin really as our hub. I mean, you go to St. Martin just for daily activities or what have you. So it shouldn't be looked at as just a ticket to another country. There should be some way that we can look at cutting down the cost of transportation over to St. Martin, and this could also potentially help with the cost of living. You know, a lot of, even from the ferries, they tell you how high the costs are of doing business here on a small island. So if there could be a larger ferry or something that also can bring goods over or what have you, you know, we'll see what can come. But something that could cut down the cost and also could help our tourism product, get people coming over, and look at it as public transportation. Point that we try to make on the island. Social affairs. Of course, this is one of the hot topics, if not the, for me, the most relevant, because from the beginning we had an agreement, January of 2008, that said we had to have an acceptable level within the Netherlands, so a Dutch level, for the areas of education, of social services, of public health, education and of safety. And in a lot of those areas we have seen improvements without a doubt. But like I said, when we talk about the social levels, what was done was that we took the former levels of the Netherlands Antilles and put a few extra dollars on them, converted them over, and said these will be the new social levels. If we were leaving a country that that was unacceptable in, then why would that be acceptable in the current country that we're in? So with the influence, or the influx, let's say, the increase of bureaucracy, there should also be the raise of the social levels. I use it all the time as an example with the Dutch government, and I say this is also a human rights issue. You have 17 million people in the Netherlands, and you have 24,000 people down here in these islands. We're basically 0.001%. So you have an old age pension that for 99.999% of our country of the Netherlands is set at one level, and then for 0.001% it's set at a low level, which is even below the poverty line. So that is unacceptable to us. That is always a highlight of our discussions, and we hope especially that with this issue that this can start to come to light. Saba, I mean, yeah, we have problems with that, and for sure on the other islands you even have more severe problems, Stacia and Bonaire. You know, with poverty in the lands there. So for all three islands, it's a very big concern, a very big issue. And it's an issue of us asking them a question. Are we part of your country? Yes or no? I always give that example. I say that we on these islands, the people had to accept certain realities of becoming part of the Netherlands. And the question is, do the Netherlands accept the reality of us becoming part of their country? So now we need to turn the question back on them and say, do you accept us as part of their country? The inspectorates. This is also an example of bureaucracy and also an example where sometimes a European mind frame or a big government structure doesn't fit the small island. So we highlight here shipping inspections, labor inspections, the requirements for the banks to give out loans to young people to anybody to build a house or to expand a business. You know, those have become so tough that we talk about the cost of doing business and the desire to do business. A lot of people don't want to invest anymore because they tell you, why would I come there? I can go to St. Kitts, I can buy a piece of property, I can get a passport within a month, I can have dinner with the Prime Minister, shake my hand and thank me for coming, and I come to your island, it's like entering North Korea because I gotta get scanned, going to Pyongyang. You know, you have to go through such a process, even to write in, or Island Secretary here, just to write in as a Dutch passport holder, to come here, where obviously we give them the top civil servant position on the island, and what a procedure just to live here, just to move here, you know? Shipping inspections. I mean, we have, if not, I would have to say the most deplorable harbor probably in the entire Caribbean. I don't think that's an understatement. When the Prime Minister Rutte was here, we took him to two, and we went to the medical school, and he gave them their certification from the Ministry of Osei Way that they had passed the education inspections. We said, see the highlight of the economy here. Now let's go to the harbor and see the low port of our economy here. You know, we were told in the Netherlands one time that anybody, any ship coming to Saba is coming from a larger port and going to a larger port. So why would you need to have shipping inspections here? But sometimes those discussions and agreements that you have, they don't necessarily translate down here to those carrying on the jobs. So somebody shows up, they want to do a shipping inspection, a small cruise ship tells you, no, I'm going to leave this port, I'm not coming here, because I'm not going to risk getting a fine from the European Union, from the Dutch government. So those are examples of things that, if those are island tasks, and based on the statute, we are allowed to have tasks over to the island. Tax for dealing as division of tasks, you know, based on the status that we have. If we have those type of tasks, then you can have a more common sense approach. And if some of them you don't necessarily need it, you need some areas of inspection, but you don't need to inspect cruise ships when they come here. St. Bart's, I mean, how many, 250,000 tourists or something like that per year, you see what's going on. And I don't believe St. Bart's has a shipping inspection. You know, they would look at it, why would you? Why would you want to chase away people who want to come here? You know, so those are examples of areas that it's not necessarily bad intentions, but when everything is just based on laws and doesn't have any more common sense or interpretation, then you see the negative effects that translate down here to these islands. And as I talked about also the AFM, the day and day. Education, also going in the right direction, without a doubt. However, you know, those are the issues that we can bring up. The scholarship system should better facilitate studying in English-speaking countries. I always use this and say, our use of the English language as a language of instruction has been approved by the Dutch government, not only that, but promoting it in Stasia. So the scholarship system should include more English-speaking places. And I understand that the announcements made so that Canada will now be included, and we're still lobbying for countries like England to also be included. Higher study finance allowance, and you know, you have to, a scholarship has to be repaid for those who study abroad, but the scholarship should also be sufficient for you to be able to study. And the cost of education, for example, in the United States can be quite a bit more than it is in Europe. So if you're going to allow scholarships to be granted for those areas, it should also fit the needs of the students who are there. More opportunities for vocational students in the Caribbean region are needed. And then we have here about justice, talks about drug use has increased since 10-10-10. I think we're talking about just a feeling of not so much control as before. We talked about searches of passengers, what is the role of the douana, what is the role of immigration. You know, so I think a lot of that was done more in the past. The report says more of that can be done. So not enough police officers patrolling the streets. That's something also that the police department always also lobbies for, to get more officers on the island. The RCN. Sailors should get better access to RCN jobs. Language issue. This is, we had examples of this just over the last few months with advertisements for people to become customs officers. Even for police officers, again, if you're allowed to use English as a language of instruction, and No offense to Papiamento as a language, but it's spoken by a few hundred thousand people. It's their identity, that's fine, very nice. But you know, we shouldn't be embarrassed about speaking the English language. I mean, it's a worldwide international language. And it should be, if a customs officer basically has to know the customs law, then and customs laws are already translated to English, there should be no reason why young locals cannot get an opportunity in that area just because of the proficiency here in Dutch. It would also show that we are accepted as being part of the Netherlands and at least part of the three islands that we're in. RCN offices should get more decision-making responsibilities. We have there listed that people say Bonaire is the new Curaçao. A lot of times you hear that you always have to hear about the back offices in Bonaire, the back offices in Bonaire. And you know, you get the feeling that a lot of that could be delegated here. I always tell them that the cry for more autonomy is not necessarily that we want to have all responsibilities. It just means that you want to have things make more sense. Autonomy is a cry for a system that works. You know, whose responsibility it is at the end of the day. It shouldn't be about a power trip. It should be about what works for your society and what doesn't. More documents from RCN should be. Bureaucracy, red tape, immigration process, and borders. Again, how many times I've heard from tourists and all that, they still can't understand that they pass through St. Martin with Dutch flag, and then they come to Saba with Dutch flag, and you know, you can see cruise ships go to other islands with thousands of people getting off. Here, the ferry comes, and still people have to stand in line, they have to go through such a system. You know, Saba's at the end of the road. We're not on the way to anywhere. You came here for a reason. And if you don't belong here, people will know within a week that guy looks suspicious. You can make arrangements with St. Martin, you can make arrangements just to have the flow of people going practical makes sense. Immigration process, I talked about that earlier, in the business community especially, to get work permits. Medical school, I always use this example. You know, they make you advertise, if the medical school wants to get a new professor, they have to advertise for 5 or 6 weeks on the island. We may have some unemployed people, but I don't think we have any unemployed professors of microbiology hanging out under the breadfruit tree there waiting for a job. You have to use common sense in certain things. The dive shops, you need a dive master, you should be able to process that very quickly. That shouldn't be, you know, reinventing the wheel and going through that process. You know, and those are just things that make practical common sense. Again, the customs, the issue about whether it's the drugs that you can be, banking and acquiring loans. Okay. The organizational structure. This is a point that is also part of this paper, if you've read it. It's a pretty big call. I don't know how successful it will be or not. Right now, you have a system where we have a national representative called the Rijksvertegenwoordiger Order. And like I said before, we have the RCN that has almost 700 employees. But when we were in the Netherlands and Antilles, we had a governor general, the last one, Frits Hoekendraad, and I think he had a cabinet of 4 or 5 people in total. And he actually had real responsibilities, he had real authority, and that was for a country of 200,000 people. Now we have 24,000 people, and we have created this structure where we have a national representative that tries to make the best into something it's not. We have no problem with our friends from Bonaire, we have no problem with our friends from Stacia, but the reality is Saba is Saba, Stacia is Stacia, and Bonaire is Bonaire. You know, if we're trying to create something that we're not, we don't have any common best history, we don't have any common old best heroes, and there's no need to have some very highly, in our opinion, to have a very highly paid position of this national representative. Told him in the past, there's two things you either have to do with it. You either have to give that position real authority so that person can make changes, or you need to just get rid of this position once and for all. Every island already has an island governor. The only actual authority that the national representative has is that if the island government hires somebody and they feel something happened that was fishy, the national representative can say, no, I'm not going to process the final hiring of that person. That's about it. Any other discussion you have, if it has to be with the Ministry of Economic Affairs or the Ministry of Health, you deal directly with those individuals in the ministry and through the Hague. You don't go through this process. So a lot of this is ceremonial, it's trying to create something that's not. The other thing is, it goes back to one of my first points, is that this is a very highly paid position. I should even say the amount here, but it's a very highly, it's public knowledge, it's from public law, it's like 165,000 euros per year. And if we're talking about efficiency, how can you explain to people that have to live day to day, that have a hard time paying an electricity bill, or have to survive off an old age pension that's below the poverty line, that you can have somebody collecting this type of money through these islands that is not really representing us? The name itself says it. It's the Rijksvertegenwoordiger, the state national representative, not the island representative. So this person is paid by the Dutch government to basically pretend as if they are our representative in the Netherlands, but it's not the case. So this could be decentralized very easily. You have three governors, each island has a governor. The governors in the past had the right to set up something for Norman. The governor always has the right to go through and say if they see something and they think something is fishy with a decision they made or so, that they can send it forward. You have direct contact then with basic cap. And then you won't have this feeling of a difference so much between the islands. You know, we do have different capacities to Bunea. You know, we have different capacities to Stacia as well. If you decentralize this position and you just make the governor of Saba and the national representative of the Netherlands for Saba, something like that, you combine that function, it's something then that you have one host on the island, it's very clear, when you're on Saba, you're on Saba. You know, when you're on Stacia, you're on Stacia. It makes a lot of sense, and it cuts down on the amount of spending. Then this money will be freed up in the budget. Nothing against people that have made money or are making money in this. But a lot of these people are able to go back to the Netherlands and get back jobs with ministries that they've had over there. The end of the day, the system should benefit the people of these islands. And that is one area that we see could easily be removed, could easily be centralized, and free up quite the budget, and this money could be spent better on the islands. You also wouldn't get the feeling sometimes that, oh, these are the national civil servants and these are the island civil servants. And Bruce told me that Garvis asked him, how many kingdoms do we have on sale? Kingdoms and kingdoms and kingdoms. I mean, it's a bit ridiculous. So that could be part of streamlining the system, and that is a proposal from us. It's nothing against the individual, it's just talking about the need for the position. It's a really investment. The best advisory council. This is also another part of this report. You get to read it. It goes quite in depth. The idea for this is like, you know, in the Netherlands you have the Council of State, Raad van State, that advises on legislation, provides information on any new laws coming in, and it can provide a human element. One of the things that I feel and that many people feel has been missing in this system is having human common sense. A lot of people can stand behind legislation and they can always say that, the law says this and the law says that. You know, we're in a process that no new laws are supposed to be coming over to these islands. Well, that is just a theory, that's not a reality. New laws are coming left and right, you see them all the time. You get a 100-page law proposal, you get a week and a half to give your answer. Sometimes you get it and the deadline's already passed. And they're just pushing through. If you have some kind of body, some kind of buffer, like a best advisory council, and you give them some actual authority, this could be the other part of offsetting the national representative. So you could put different individuals in that that have known these islands from the past, similar to how the people were picked for the evaluation committee, but you have former politicians, Hans Hille, Tom de Graaf, Marieke Lintors, different ones from the Netherlands that the Dutch government can trust, but also that know the islands. You can have Jaime Saleh, you can have Glenn today, you can have people practical with common sense that can say, no, sorry, ministry of whomever, this law is not needed right now. We're going to put that on hold for the next few years. That group of people can actually come here, can actually talk with human beings, can really hear, put a human element into what the problems are. You're not going to solve everything right now, we'd like to, but in reality then we'll find out that new laws come in place that next year need to be solved. So if you have a sort of advisory council that's put in place, you can have, in my opinion, you can have the element of common sense and human interpretation put in over the next few years. And this could be something that could make the system make more sense again for the people now. So So that is part of it, and again, it's covered more on that at the end of the report. You have to see also, again, with our colleagues from Stacia, from Bonaire, if they agree with this standpoint. You know, it's not, we're not on our own, we are just one of the four, so we have to see what the Netherlands comes with, and Stacia and Bonaire. But we're putting this as a proposal, at least for discussion. It says, Saba should have more say in the allocation of funds for our island government, less designated allowance and more free allowance. This is talking about the general island budget. Follow recommendations of the Inversa reports. Again, has to do within the budget with regards to the height of the budget for local government. Okay. Content is more flexibility within the ministries to allocate funds to the real needs of the island. So this is also talking about setting of priorities. Nothing against nature funding and all that, but there was 10 million euros that was sent for nature for the three islands. And we said if you'd have asked any of the three islands, each one of the islands would have told you social economic development at this point is more important if you have so much funds to invest in. So let the islands set the priorities. We're not saying nature is not important, not whatsoever, but if you have so much money to work with, you have to address the needs first, poverty alleviation, cost of living, economic development. Capacity of local government needs strengthening, and Dutch subsidy programs should be open for sale. Vision of government tasks, the vision of tasks between national and local government should be reconsidered. Tasks should be moved to public entities where possible. If the means, follow the tasks. So, again, the means, pick out the money. If the money comes along with it, execute the task. But it also has to do with a point before about having common sense. So, if you have shipping inspections on Saba, do you, you know, come with a list of requirements that ship should have, yeah, with life vests and stuff like that. But then, yeah, it comes to a point where that's all you need for a small port like Saba. You don't need to have somebody jumping on a cruise ship and saying, I'm going to check your hull today. Those are crazy problems that take place. The level of provisions, this is in Dutch, the voorziening vote. In considering the level of provisions, national government has to consider the lack of social institutions savings can use, for safe house, for rehabilitation, for detention, etc. The old age pension for single seniors is too low, gone through that sometimes. Not enough social housing to meet the demand, also has to do with the high cost of building here. Comprehensive plan needs to be put in place to achieve an acceptable standard of living, which we also discussed a little bit before about putting things like abstract ideas into real figures. When you talk about acceptable and not acceptable, poverty and not poverty, you need to once and for all have levels that are created and say, you know, this is what we agree upon, this is what truly is needed for the island. With the conclusions, overview of the most important points and political state. All right, well, then from there, I don't know how I did on time, did I make your ears bleed? Okay, I spoke too much too long, sorry. So for the conclusions, then, well, as you can see, this is where we've reached at this point. Let me just end then talking a little bit about the process real quick. We have some guests over here from Bonaire in the back. We have Commissioner Clark Abraham sitting in the back there. Mr. Jan de Vries. Clark, please stand up, please. Hello, people.
Hello.
We have Commissioner Reginald Sandam also coming from Stacia on Friday. And then on Saba, we will be having members of the first and second chamber coming to the island on Friday afternoon. The delegation is 11 total members. Yeah. So, and two registered, 13 in total?
Nine
actual members, and 11 with two registrars from the first and second chamber. So, they'll be coming to the island, and we will be having a Saba summit. And the idea is, hopefully, that with the momentum created by the evaluation report, that we can get together, we can come to some concrete conclusions, what we need to do, and really make some a way forward for the people here. So they are coming here, they're getting a chance to meet with island council members on Friday evening, with the advisory committee is also invited and to mingle. Then on Saturday we'll be having meetings here And then on Saturday afternoon, there will actually be a meet and greet for the public, which will be starting at 2:30 over by the Red Lion Plaza, Peterson's establishment over there. It's going to be hosted by the Hideaway, a new business. That refreshments can be served there, and then people can mingle, and you can meet the members of the second chamber, the first chamber. Like I said, I mean, in Saba, I think we do have a little bit of a privilege with that, that we're able to, a lot of them, you know each other and know them very well. People from Saba, I've met many of them before, know them well. So please come to that, get the chance, speak to those representatives. And that is where we'll be taking it from there. After that summit, then there will be a point where three islands will give that together their conclusions, which includes our standpoint, constitutional evaluation, but also from Bonaire and from Stacia. And then those will be handed over to the Dutch government officially. And then from there, the process will continue with the ministries, the Minister Plaster, the Basic Cap, and there'll be a whole process to see how we can go forward and correct those problems. So with that, I will conclude this part. Let me also then say the idea for this evening. You've been listening to me here for over an hour, I think, or at least an hour of talking. So sorry about keeping you here that long. We will have a period. If people would like to ask a question or make a statement, we have it broken up into two ideas. One can also be in this open forum if anybody has comments to make about the report and specific questions or what have you. And then what the idea is that we can also break into smaller groups. There's some tables set around over there. So Kuhn and Tim and Vito, Pete are here, different ones are here that if you want to bring a specific comment, if you've read the report and you feel something is missing that needs to be addressed, even to ask, if you didn't read the report, but you want to say, okay, but was this addressed in the report? Please feel free to do that. And then from there, this is still an actual draft. So, you know, we get some input, looking for input. And then based on that, changes can again be made tomorrow, or additions can be made. And then we will have a final version, at least Saba's version. Like I said, it's quite a process with partners and that whole aspect. But for now, this will be then Saba's version, polished version, that everybody can have. And then from there, through the process as it goes along, as we get reports coming back, counter proposals, discussions, then those will be brought in public and everybody can get a chance to have the input. So with that, I say thank you. And we'll move over to time now if anybody has any questions or comments.
I think we're to that stage now, although the There are members of the first and second chamber coming here tomorrow evening. I still think that the time has come. After all of this, I think most everybody, if not everybody in this room, agrees with all the ideas and points and concerns that have been brought forward here this evening. I think it's very relevant that all of these concerns be addressed by the second chamber. Otherwise, this whole evaluation process would have been a failure, a farce, so to speak, because you came here, you took up people's time, you questioned them, you almost dragged your souls out to tell them what is wrong, and they did so very willingly, because the concerns are alive here on Saba. You know, we are a happy bunch of people. Somebody said here this evening, yourself, Mr. Commissioner, that this is paradise. If you turn on the TV and see what's happening in the Middle East, this is really paradise. It doesn't get much better than this, but there are still some shortcomings in paradise. And those shortcomings have to be addressed. We know what's taking place in France and Belgium. You even start to ask yourself, I wonder when the Netherlands will be next. Those possibilities are there. I told my daughter she's going along with the director of tourism to the Vakantieburg. If you hear a firecracker go off, knock, fall on the floor, because you don't know. And here in Saba, we don't have to worry about that. What we heard here for the last days at the end of the year were really what it was, firecrackers. But not so in the rest of the world. But coming back to the evaluation, I think it's clear to everybody who has the bite bullet. The second chamber. They have to decide, and we all realize, you know, their constituents are in Holland. Their votes are gotten there. At the end of the day, they are politicians, so it's not an easy task for them either. But nevertheless, this is the reality here. We are still flying the Dutch flag, and as you said, we're either part or we're not part. Thank you.
Really emphasize also then on the need for people to please come Saturday to the meet and greet. Get you a chance to meet those members, Van Raat and Bosman and all the court, the regular, from the usual suspects will be there. So please come and emphasize to them that we are expecting them to, but they have to make some changes. Anybody else? Okay, well then, maybe if some of you have specific content in some smaller groups, like I said, we have different individuals who will be sitting around. If you have specific points that you want to bring up, there's also the government information email address. Vito, you have?
info@sabagov.nl.
So also if people want to email in comments that you have, of course you can always email in any comment. But if it's specifically about a report, that would be very helpful. If you have a page, number, and an example, I'll give you an example. When the advisory committee met a number of occasions, I met just once with them. But even in that meeting, Anita Heilbron was there, and she made a great point about we had forgot to mention MoneyGram and Western Union and those things that have made it hard for foreigners or even for locals to send money abroad to family members and what have you. So if you have an example or an idea about things that are missing from the report, then please feel free to email that in. Like I said, if you read a report, you can use the specific page, the subject, that would be great. Or even general comments, that's also most welcome. So with that then, thank you all for coming here this evening. There's also some snacks and so provided. And like I said, you can see Kuhn and Vito, Pete or Tim will be around here. Myself, Bruce, the governor is here also. So if you want to make any more comments or observations, please feel free to do so. Thank you all very much for coming.